by that.
That's what I'm not the user.
Where you get near your cabinet or you do yourself?
If y'all haven't signed Nana's guests, we got a signing sheet back here that are in his back as well. Oh, I know, I saw that picture behind you.
Yeah.
I'm about it.
And I lived to talk about it.
What do you think you had?
What kind of bike you have, huh?
I have a handle.
Hey. You went to a real life bike?
Yes.
I said, why did it? You have to go with 35.
September 9th, meeting of the Bob Lowndes County Zoning Board of Appeals to order. Ladies and gentlemen, Tracy just mentioned that if you hadn't already signed, please do so in the back of the room. We have a total of 6 cases today, 3 for Lowndes County and 3 for the city of Valdosta. So I think most of you have probably been here before. If you haven't, I'll just tell you real quick, the staff will come up and present the case to us, give us, many of the details as they can, and then we'll give you an opportunity to speak as well as any opposition. So just kind of a simple format. So without further ado, we'll get started with the first Lowndes County case, VAR 2014-08, was actually a case that was brought before us by the Lowndes County Board of Commissioners, and it has been withdrawn unless something's changed in the past few minutes.
That is correct, Chairman. As of this afternoon, I received an email from Lowndes County staff withdrawing the request. So no action is necessary.
Okay. All right. The next case is VAR 2014-11, Rodney and Karen Kane, 6105 R. Dustin Kane Street, a hour.
Yes, sir. This request this afternoon is a variance request to our single-family home design standards. This is a situation where Mr. Kane developed this property for a residential subdivision back in 1998. He was on the process because he wanted a home subdivision. With the 2006 adoption of the ORDC, that zoning was deleted and replaced with residential zoning, similar to a case you had last month. What you have here is a mixture of single family, single wide and double wide, most of which are single wide. There was a single wide on this particular lot, and the applicant would like to replace it with another single wide. They can't do that as a matter of right and without variance. We are talking with the property owner about doing a vested rights case to the Board of Commissioners, because it's something we feel, we have a vested right, but only the Board of Commissioners can decide that. So we're talking with him about going through that process, so he will come forward to this process every time he wants to replace a home. With that, staff made a recommendation of approval, citing several criteria and standards.
Well, the new single wide did an updated one to what is already there.
Actually, what was there previously is on the screen to your left. What is being replaced is the pick on the right. It's very similar, yes. Very similar. The applicant is here, the applicant's representative is here, and can answer any questions. I believe the home is situated in Mineola. Not sure if it's in the mobile home park at Mineola, and she's moving it from that location to this property.
Any other questions? Thank you. I'm assuming the applicant is here. Would you like to come up and speak, Mr. Campbell? If you will, just make sure you state your name and address for the record, please.
Mine is Sandra Dean. I'm a cousin to Jeff Brooks, who's wanting to move it out there. We live out there. She can't drive.
Can I have your address too, please, for the minutes, please?
Pardon?
Your address, please?
Oh, I'm sorry, but it's in Cane Plantation. She can't drive, and my aunt has always had to take her where she goes, and she's crippled now, can't, so I'm going to take over helping her. And it's just more convenient to have her out there close to us, beside us, or to help her.
And you're the lady that wrote the letter for us, it's our practice?
Yes.
Sorry, what'd you change to?
She is, Ms. Sandra Dean is the same that's in our packet.
Okay, okay.
Kind of explained, and just wanted to make sure we pointed that out. They don't have a question about that?
Thank you.
Is there anyone else here in the audience that might speak in favor of this request? Seeing none, is there anyone here who'd like to speak in opposition to this request? Anyone at all? Carmelo, is there any notifications to your office, any issues or concerns from any neighbors?
No, sir.
Okay. Board, do you have any questions? I'll entertain a motion, please.
I'll make a motion to approve, citing criteria D.
Okay, I have a motion.
Second.
Second, Ms. Gaskin. All in favor, signify by raising your hand. Unanimous. Thank you very much. Okay, our next case is VAR 2014-12, Ralph and Sarah Russell, Backer Road Road.
Yes, sir, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This next case is a variance to our non-conforming standards. What we have in this case, the properties, the Russell's property is currently zoned highway commercial. He has a residence as well as an accessory building on the property, which is deemed legal, non-conforming. He had a situation recently where a tree fell on his accessory building, and he would like to replace that accessory building with another similar in size. With a non-conforming standard, you cannot replace a non-conforming use with another without, you know, seeking variance. That's why he's before you today. Staff looked at this, recommended approval. We did offer some other alternatives, such as rezoning this property to residential, so he won't have to go through this process anytime he wants to expand or replace. But he rather keeps his commercial zoning, and we respect that. So with that, I'll answer any questions.
And this accessory structure is on a slab?
I'm not sure, but the applicant is here.
Okay. And we're not increasing the size of it?
No, sir.
Any questions for Ms. Price? Thank you, ma'am. Is the applicant here and would like to come speak?
Yes, sir.
If so, give us your name and address, please, sir.
My name is Ralph Russell, address 3312 Tobacco Road Road, and thank you for being here this afternoon. I do encourage, thank you for being able to speak to you. My wife and I have lived this rest 36 years. During this time, we had this accessory building, which was built under permit in 1980, and through an act of God on June 21st, high winds came up and blew it down, and also heavily damaged it, also totaled out my truck, and heavily damaged my wife's car. The intent of the application would allow us, if you approve it, to put the same structure on the same slab in the same location. And we just, we really need it because we need a place to store stuff and park the car. That's what we're seeking to do. And I ask for your approval. Do you have any questions about my answer?
Any questions, Mr. Russell? Thank you, Mr. Russell. Is there anyone else here who would like to speak in favor of this request? Seeing none, anyone here to speak against this request? Anyone nearby take issue with this request? Seeing none, are there any questions among the board? Anything we need to clarify? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Chair, I did receive a phone call from a nearby neighbor, Mr. Rick Andrew, who is in support of this request.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
Siding criteria D.
All in favor, signify by raising your hand.
I salute you, thank you.
Good luck. Thank you, Ms. Bradwell. Mr. Russell, do you want these pictures back, or?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yes, sir. Ms. Tolly, are you ready with the City of Valdosta cases?
Oh, I'm just ready to slide your phone.
We can wait on them.
I'm ready.
Our first two cases are the ones that were tabled. Dr. Holmes tabled them last week.
First one is on the corner of Smith Briar and North Oak Street. It is currently consisting of a medical office, a multi-tenant office building, including Dr. Robinson's office, and athletic parking driveways. The reason this is in front of you is because he is interested in solar energy, green energy, which is a separate issue, for lack of a better term. It's not related specifically to the various requests that is in front of you. What he's proposing to put those solar panels on is a carport-like structure, as shown right there. It will be on top of the beams and forms for a variety of sources. This picture there. Staff reviewed the request, and normally accessory structures are required to be either in the side of the rear yard, not close to the street, and at least 10 feet away from a side rear property. This is proposed to be in the front yard along North Oak Street and approximately 6 feet away from the front property. Two variances, location and distance away from property lines. Staff had some concerns specifically about the location and to throw in a couple of concerns, aesthetics as you're driving down the street. And then the second concern would be the trees and the growing. We do have our city arborist, Kendra Jenkins, who's available for any questions related to the trees. And Kevin may like to comment. Available for questions?
Yeah, available for questions.
Okay. Available for questions if need be. Staff reviewed it, found it not to meet the criteria, and having that hardship in that form, we recommend it. Any questions?
Questions from the board, Ms. Tolley? I think we were all present last month. Any questions for City Arborist? Okay, thank y'all. Dr. Wallace is here. Would y'all like to, do you have any new information to present?
We'll put them both together and we'll talk about it.
It's the same, obviously. Maybe we can put both cases together. It's the same thing.
I understand, but I think the board, and I think based on what I heard last month, I think it'd probably be, I mean, you're welcome to show us the information for both at the same time, but I think we need to keep them separate. Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
have some alterations, yes, sir. The architect is not, his wife was taken to Mayo Clinic, so he had to take it down. What the architect did is he proposed the, there's a, the proposal is to go here.
Hey, if you will, okay, let's go ahead and formalize this and provide me your name.
Now, I'm Greg Kelly.
Is there, are there enough copies for staff to have one?
This is the lot with addition of the architect's drawing.
Okay, so there's an additional?
Well, we, this piece here, we talked about it was connected, that it would change the request, and I'm not, he's the architect, so I don't know what the code is.
So, hold on, so staff is unaware of any new information at this point, prior to this meeting, and y'all not seen any of this?
I have not. I know we spoke with Matt, and Matt was unable to obtain a copy for us to sit down and look at. This is the first time I've seen this.
Last week we came, and we talked to you, so we heard the meeting is going to be a week before, and we, Matt was here, so we talked to him about all these changes.
Is Matt available?
Let me go see. And
I mean, my concern is that Matt's not here, this new information, Matt may have it in the working basin on the staff report, if we're looking at something different.
We did discuss it, and of course you're receiving this second hand, so to speak, for me. If it's going to be attached, then it has to go by traditional building setbacks for that district, and I don't know if this needs to come.
Okay, but in terms of protocol, should your office have the benefit of all this information?
We would. I would have preferred to have had this before 5 minutes ago.
Okay.
I agree.
Would this affect your position?
No.
So you regardless, or regardless?
Correct.
What are the changes that have been made?
Okay, let's let him present the changes to us. I don't know whether to do that.
We need to hear what your changes are.
The change would be to, the one proposal would be to accept the way it was laid out and put a carport out there. The Matt had said possibly change it and so add a walkway. A covered walkway, and that would, people could have their wheelchair or they could walk under it in the rain or bad weather or hot weather, and so the architect has done that. So he's added that to
down on the end.
Staff has questions. Like I said, we haven't had a chance to sit down and look at this thoroughly yet. Given the fact that there's apparently a walkway or a covering that's been added, it changes it to become an addition rather than accessory structures, and it has to meet traditional building setbacks. This is an RP, so the oak tree would have to be 25 feet from the property line, not the center line of right of way, but from the property line where Dr. Roberts' property meets the right of way. The Smith Brown side would be a secondary front, so it would have to be 15 feet from the property line. And I do not know if this does or not. If that's what they're proposing, then that's what they would have to do.
But you can't make a determination about the staff's position on it because you're saying you don't have sufficient information prior to this discussion.
I would have liked to have had this information before, but that's the end result, is that they're going to have to meet setbacks.
And my understanding is those requests and that application for a variance to that setback is not included in this application, correct?
Correct, it was advertised as a, as an accessory structure. Now, there is a backdoor method to considering this, if CPOA is so willing, and I'm stressing the backdoor method. You could approve, if you are willing, and again, I would like to know what we're approving, if you're so inclined, I would like to have some time to study this. If you're inclined to consider and potentially approve, you could approve the accessory structures as shown on the site plan with the connection, or the condition that they be connected.
Oh, interesting. So then it not is not a accessory structure, nor is it an addition. It's an accessory structure with a covered walkway, with the condition that it have a covered walkway from the building to the parking area.
You are correct. It's a broken.
Well, what about front yard setback?
Well, we would grant the variance on the front yard setback for the accessory structure, provided the accessory structure has a covered walkway to the building so that the patients can safely get out of their car in the bad weather, heat or rain, not be covered up in whatever it is, go to the walkway and get to the building.
And keep in mind, you still have, there's the question still of hardship.
Go ahead, Tom.
I'm not able to tell you much about just this one. Tracy, my understanding was Matt said that as long as it was connected to the building, then they didn't even have to go through zoning, as long as they met the setbacks.
If they meet the setbacks, and I don't know one way or the other what the setback, if they meet the setbacks and they connect it with the walkway, then staff will view it as an addition. If they meet the setbacks and they come, I can sign off the variance.
But the setback on the front yard side is 25 feet.
Right, it's right. Shown on this drawing. That dashed line is shown on this drawing.
Keep in mind, that's the back door method that we talked about a minute ago.
Right, well, but what, that's not 25 feet from the lot.
That, the 25 feet is not, that's
right,
a separate issue. If it's something, if you're doing it as an accessory structure.
Right.
And which is the request is to replace accessory structures too much in the street. If you view those as accessory structures and you still view it as an accessory structure, even though the walkway is there connected.
Right.
If you view that as an accessory structure connected to the office with the walkway, you can grant the variance. If you're so approved, you can grant the variance for the location, setbacks, for the accessory structures.
Right.
With the condition that they be attached to show.
Right.
If that's they back door method.
I understand. If they were to say this is an addition to our building, then it would need to be 25 feet from the street.
Correct.
So they would have to move them to the other side of the parking lot.
They would have to make some changes. If CPOA chooses to.
Is the applicant okay with us just delaying this?
Yes, sure.
Y'all hang around and
wait on that.
Maybe we can skip to the other, you know, case. It's just much shorter from the street. I think that would be a different situation than next.
Well, let's get both of your cases all together if the board's okay with that. Let's hear the final case of the day.
We can't look at that.
We'll get the other case. You call him up and
sign. We did meet with him last Tuesday here.
And I'd like to explain again. I wish you had given him a copy of this before we shut up the meeting.
Okay, so y'all are good with us doing that?
Yes.
Move it to the end of the meeting. I make the motion that we move these two cases to the end of the meeting.
Thank you.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous. superintendent.
Okay, who seconded that motion? Who made the motion?
I made the motion.
Gretchen made it, and,
And Paul seconded. Are you ready for your next case?
Okay, all right, the next case is APP 2014-09, Coffin Construction, 1705 Norman Drive.
Okay, this property is 1705 Norman Drive, located on the corner of Norman Drive and Marcy and Augustine Road, Promenade Plaza. It is a multi-tenant shopping facility, grocery stores, retail facilities, things of that nature. What they are proposing, they have a prospective tenant for this parcel right here. It is a separate parcel, but because it's going to be benefiting, it's we're viewing it as a shopping complex rather than a standalone development. They've got a multi-tenant building that is proposed to be built on this particular piece of property. As far as I know, one tenant potential. I'm not sure about the second tenant. Site plan is here. What they are proposing. If you'll remember, you saw this property approximately 3 or 4 years ago when Shoe Carnival came through. What they're proposing, there's a sign here with Books a Million and Shoe Carnival, freestanding sign. There is, we're considering Sunny's to be a part of the complex as well. Sunny's has its own sign, 125 square feet. There is a second sign right here. That is Promenade Plaza, as well as several multi-tenant facilities in that shopping complex. What happens is, for multi-tenant facilities, they are allowed primary frontage signs and secondary frontage signs. We're considering St. Augustine the secondary frontage. Under today's code, you're looking at 125 square feet for each of the signs along Norman Drive, which is the primary frontage. For St. Augustine, you're looking at half that, about 62.5 square feet, maybe if my memory is correct. These signs, you're looking at 125 square feet each. Under today's circumstances, and keep in mind these were all permitted under prior regulations, under today's circumstances, you can have one of those 125 square foot signs per entrance. So in theory, one here, and one here. With one condition, that those signs be at least 300 feet apart. Under today's circumstances, I couldn't permit another freestanding sign along here because you've got approximately 850 feet from right here through the parking lot today right here. So the most that I could permit under today's circumstances without a variance would be two freestanding signs along this frontage, each 125 square feet, 35 feet tall. I know that's confusing. What they're proposing, they looked at several different options, including a monument sign request. Apparently that was option number two. Option number one, and what is the request in front of you, is an additional panel on the sign that is right here. Which looks like this right now. You've got Best Buy, you've got Shoe Carnival, you've got Books a Million. They're proposing to add another 50 square foot panel on that sign, bringing it from 160 feet square feet to 210 square feet. Now this sign and the one at St. Augustine were the ones that received variances for additional freestanding signage in 2010. You approved one to be 70 square feet, and the other one to be 72.5 square feet. Anyway, a little bit more than 70 square feet for each size. Staff did review the request, unfortunately did not find hardship, and recommended for denial. I know that's a lot. I know that's a lot of numbers, a lot of process. Any questions? Any questions?
You said that Norman Drive, you're supposed to have 900 feet.
Yeah.
If you're going to have the three signs.
Yes.
And right now, you've got 300 in between. Right now, you've got 850.
You've got 850 from right here at McDonald's to right here at the Ventura Center, where it goes into the bank.
So basically, you're just short 53.
Right. Now, keep in mind, they've already got three signs along the front, permitted under previous regulations.
I have two questions. The parcel, Sunny sits on the parcel, it's not a separate...
You are correct, it's not a separate parcel.
Okay. The proposed one that was outlined in blue before is a separate parcel?
Mm-hmm.
So why doesn't it have its own rules?
Because much like Sunny's, we view it as one complex.
No. Sunny's is on the parcel.
Uh-huh.
So it's not separate.
Sunny's is a separate parcel.
Oh, Sunny's is a separate parcel.
Sunny's is a separate parcel. It's this one right here.
Okay, so Sunny's has it, so it should have its own rights. And then the outline in yellow should have its own rights. And the one in blue should have its own rights. If I bought that piece that's in blue, I should be able to put a sign on it.
Question make you think. Do you realize how many of our multi-tenant facilities are on more than one parcel? We've got several that are on one.
Well, okay, but that, be that as it may, that's a piece of property that could be sold as a piece of property. No subdivision happening as an independent piece of property, so it has its own rights.
I got a question. Is the separate parcel that's being sold, is that going to be owned by the same people that own the promenade?
That I'm not sure. The applicant may know.
Separate parcel doesn't matter.
It does have the potential, just like this one does, just like that one does.
I saw it as a regression.
Well, I mean, I agree with you. I mean, if that's a separate owner, it's me buying a property in blue, and it's a separate parcel, they should have their own sign.
Yeah. Paul and I want to buy that piece of property, and we're going to put a sign that says Gretchen and Paul's something, you know.
Sure, whatever.
Exactly. We should be able to put a sign there.
Can't you make it a shelf for kids or something?
Yeah, we have no shoes for
them. As long as they're law.
The beach store.
Okay, enough.
This is essentially the same question I had, was why wasn't the bank considered as part of it? I mean, if you're considering, you are not considering Sunny's a part of the calculation.
We are.
You are, but then you're not considering the bank or the Mexican restaurant a part of your calculation.
Azteca.
I understand.
Okay.
It is a gray area, which we do understand.
Okay.
So what are we
just wanted to clarify.
Are there any other questions?
I'm confused.
They should have some rights. That's what we're saying.
Let's say give them
another one. Chuck, are you
going to
speak on behalf of the applicant?
Yeah.
Bruce, you will first. Either of you.
Okay. All right.
Thank you for your time. My name is Bruce Smith. I'm 2941 Lock Ball Road. And again, I think I can do it here. Our assumption has been that these parcels are separate, and that potentially could become a separate parcel at some point. So in our minds, these would be considered their own parcels and have their own signage. We're at 850 feet of frontage here. We're very close to the 900. So we know we don't need it, but we know we're very close. We also know that these two signs are already exceeding the 125. And we're not proposing to put another sign down here because we know we're less than the 300 feet clear. We understand the issues there. But what we propose, we're so close to that, we're really just asking for that additional panel on an existing sign. If you do the calculations, you've got basically the potential for three signs 50 feet short, and that gives you the, is it 350 square feet total?
375.
And if we add the additional 50-foot panel to the two signs, then we're really only asking for 15 additional square feet of sign for what would be allowed if we had that full 900. So we feel like we're so close. There is the potential that this could be sold off as a separate parcel in the future. Initially, no, but it will be parceled out as and potentially sell it off. So we felt like being that close to the 900 feet and really only needing 15 square feet of additional signage on an existing sign, it was worth at least asking to see how you guys would feel about that. By definition, the hardship issue, there's no proof that this property creates hardship to do this, but there is a national tenant that will probably walk away from this deal. I know that's not this board's consideration, but there are real life hardships here that, you know, in a tough economy, we're trying to improve Valdosta, we're trying to get a more significant tax base, and I understand the LDR is there for a reason, and a good reason, and I support it, but sometimes it just makes a little bit of sense to consider squeezing a little bit extra to help someone do something that's positive for the community in our eyes. So we just feel like it was worth asking to see if this committee would consider that.
Can you tell us who attended this?
Five Guys, Burgers and Fries is the national tenant that will most likely call Select Comfort. Select Comfort is another tenant. And we're proposing two 25 square foot panels, one for each, and one 50 foot